Nowadays, all the news you need is right at your fingertips. So how are all these changes in new media affecting us here in NEOtropolis? Stay tuned. This is not business as usual.
Thanks for joining us for this edition of NEOtropolis. With help from our content partners, Crain's Cleveland Business, the Youngstown Business Journal, and CoolCleveland.com, we'll keep you up to date on the very latest business and financial news throughout Northeast Ohio. And as always, we want to hear from you. Check us out on Facebook, Twitter, and on our website, neotropolis.org. After all, it's your region too.
Traditional media as we know it is changing due to new technology and the economy. Reporter Jennifer Boris met with publishing and broadcasting leaders in our region to find out how they're managing the transition.
Thanks, Thomas. You know, for years we've defined traditional media as TV, radio, and print. That's still true, but many changes are being made right now to stay competitive.
Our subscription base was not falling like a daily newspaper subscription base is falling, because we're not a daily. We always had our niche. However, we understand that our readers are gravitating towards the web because people want news at their fingertips when they want it. So we had to sit down and figure out what are our products, how are we reaching people. We started our daily webcast November 16th, and it's a 6-minute, 7-minute newscast every business day that we post around 1 o'clock in the afternoon, and we email that as well to subscribers. So they get our daily email headlines at 7:45, and about 1 o'clock in the afternoon, we like to say when they come back from lunch, we email them our newscast. So we're trying to reach people with new delivery systems. We're still doing local news because that ultimately is our stock in trade, is local business news. But the change is how people are receiving that news, and we have to continue to change our distribution forms.
Interestingly enough, I think it's MediaMark Research, in the past decade, readership for magazines has increased 8%. So magazines aren't going away according to the people that are picking them up on the newsstand and who are subscribing to them. Well, I think that you will see publications like Cleveland Magazine start adopting, you know, the e-book format. I mean, the realistic possibility that Cleveland Magazine, you know, you'll be able to get on your Kindle someday. And but at the same time, I think that the printed piece doesn't go away.
Print isn't the only form of media going through a transition. Let's find out what's new here at WKYC.
To me, WKYC is the premier news station in Northeast Ohio. I think one of the biggest things we have going for us that some of the other, the networks and the cable stations don't, is that we are local. Whether it's on television, on that platform, or whether it's on the web platform, we're still local. We're local, whereas Google or Yahoo or something like that, they're not local. The viewer has so many different choices that if you're not providing for them what they want, they're going to go someplace else and find it. So we're seeing not just our traditional newscasts, but finding different ways to do it and different ways to include the viewer. The viewer doesn't make an appointment to watch us anymore. There's too many choices out there. So we have to give them reasons why they do need to come to us.
Now with us tonight to discuss these issues and more, our panelists Chuck Soder from Crain's Cleveland Business, Marcy Papafava from WAKR Radio, and author, entrepreneur, and new media maven, Jim Kukral. Thank you all for joining us tonight. We just saw a segment where traditional media says they're doing fine in a lot of ways. There are changes, but they're adopting to it. However, they also admit that it's about the way news is delivered, and it's changing. Chuck, are they doomed? Because if you're print, you're delivering it in print. If you're broadcast, you're delivering in broadcast. And if people don't want to receive it that way, are you kind of stuck?
Well, I would say that it's not the case that they're doomed. I would say that the paper delivery of news, that is going to go away. I don't know when it's going to go away. I don't think it's going to be in the next 10 years. Nothing too much of a doomsday scenario. But I definitely think that that format is going to go away.
So they've got to come up with other options. They've got to come up with other ways to deliver the news in a way. Marcy, you've been in print broadcast yourself, radio a lot. Yeah, are they adapting to these new media outlets?
You have to adapt or you're going to die. I know the newspaper industry is having a really tough time because there's a big cost structure behind that with the printing presses, the delivery, ink and paper. Radio, it's a little different. We have more fixed costs. Do I think traditional media is going to go away forever? No. I mean, radio didn't go away when TV came out. TV didn't go away when cable came out. Cable didn't go away when satellite came out. But I think there are changes. And, you know, where the content may be the same, you have to be where your customers are right now. So you have to have new delivery methods. You know, when I started at WAKR a couple of years ago, we didn't have internet. We didn't have AkronNewsNow.com. We had one computer where you could pick up email. Now we're on email all day long. We're on Akron News.
Right.
We're on Facebook.
Right.
We're on Twitter. We do a daily vodcast.
Sure.
We have a mobile application.
So you're doing a lot of things besides just radio.
But
I'm guaranteeing that most of your revenue is still coming through the radio channel. So, Jim, is that what's really happening here? Is it's the advertisers that are saying, hey, the advertisers are moving their money. They're moving it away from traditional media, aren't
they? Well, I think advertisers are a little bit fed up from having to work in a media that really could not provide them direct results for so many years. And now you have things like social media and being able to actually go out and target a single person, a Catholic woman who lives in Lorain County. I can run an ad on Facebook and target that specific person and put an ad right in front of that person. You can't do that when you're putting out a big publication.
Right.
I mean, one thing I want to bring up is that this year on Amazon.com, the sales from Kindle, from digital downloads, outproduced printed publications. I think that was really a benchmark moment in all the stuff that's happening.
Already, and the Kindle's only been out less than a year or
and,
so.
You know, I have a 7 and a 3-year-old, and do I think that my 3-year-old will ever read a newspaper as I read it today?
Right.
I doubt it.
Right. So that's going away. Are they changing, though, Marcy? I mean, are they really adapting these new technologies, traditional media?
Some traditional media is adapting new technologies. Some are slower to jump on the bad bandwagon than others.
Right.
But, I mean, you really do need to adopt what's new in the marketplace or you're going to have trouble. Think about Kodak, for example, when digital photography came out, and they should have been the leader in digital photography, and they didn't. They sat back and they worked on other part of their product, and you know, other competitors came into the marketplace and they took their market share. So you have to adapt. The smart media companies will adapt. Absolutely.
And, you know, just to add to the conversation here, I think right now adapting to technology is a necessity, but I don't think it's enough for these media outlets to survive. Maybe if they do the technology, I mean, everybody has a website already. You know, all these papers, they all have websites. I'm not in radio, but I'm guessing that pretty much all radio stations have some sort of website, some sort of substance on it. And, you know, having a website's not enough, then you need to, you know, provide news for the mobile channel, and you need to go further than that, though. Because right now, the business model of just providing straight up news the way we're doing it now through those channels, you know, there's plenty of news on BlackBerry, but the people producing it aren't necessarily getting the return on investment right now. The recession is having a big impact.
So what's the answer?
But
the
long-term impact,
you know,
looking for that one.
The thing that I saw when we watched that clip before that was on right before us was everyone was talking about choice. And that's exactly what it is right now. Consumers want to get the content the way they want to get it.
When
they want to get it. And we had this conversation before we came on. We talked about some people will only want to contact me through Facebook.
Right.
I know some people who will only contact me through Twitter. Consumers now have so many choices, and I'm glad to see that traditional media is picking up on that and understanding that you're going to have to deliver the content the way the consumer wants it, when they want it, if you're going to survive in this economy.
And the consumers are everywhere. Again, at the conversation before we came on here, we said some people still fax today.
Right.
I mean, think about that. Some people are faxing, and other people are only contacting
you. I can't fax from my iPhone.
You can't fax from
I can.
There's an iPhone app for that. I think
there is. Google's new phone.
Yeah.
Okay.
And, you know, other people only contact you through Twitter. You have to be everywhere, you know, depending on who you want to reach.
So what's that like when you're at a radio station and you're being asked to also tweet and also man the Facebook page. I mean, are they working you guys in traditional media to death here, juggling three, four different things? Is that what it's come to?
No, you have to pick your battles. I mean, you're going to tweet what's really important. That means that's the story you're going to spend the most time on. So, no, it changes your daily structure. Mm-hmm. It changes, you know, different things that you would do in a day. But, no, they're not working you to death, and it's a case of time management as anything.
And I'd say that my editors actually do the tweeting for Cranes. But, yeah, I think the picking your battles phrase sums it up pretty well. They don't post all of our stories to Twitter.
Right.
We used to post all of them to Facebook.
Yeah, yeah.
And people were complaining.
Yeah, but I wish you would do that. I wish you would do that because I get 100% of my news and information from Facebook and Twitter, usually mostly Twitter.
That's right. Thank you very much. Thank you. You thought social media was a fad? Well, it appears to be here to stay. Sites like Facebook, Twitter, and LinkedIn are becoming more and more popular, especially among entrepreneurs and business leaders who realize the potential. Jennifer Boris traveled around the region to find out what impact this growing trend is having on companies right here in NEOtropolis.
Social media is very important to Marcus Thomas. One of the main reasons is that it's growing exponentially. In the last year, the number of Fortune 500 companies that are not using social media have gone from 43% to 9%. So only 9% of the Fortune 500 are not using social. So clearly, it's a new tool in the whole marketing communications toolbox that people are using more and more of.
Well, I mean, just in terms of revenue generation, it's still the name of the game here is still broadcast. And we understand that. No one has really been able to figure out a way yet to monetize the social media space, and that's why we realize that it's more of a powerful tool for promoting the platforms that are monetized here at WKYC. So I think that they all have to work together somehow in tandem.
I think people were afraid of it before because you can't control it as much as you can a media buy. So you can't just push out the information, and I think people were afraid. But they're seeing the power of it now, and the power of it is that if you have a brand that people can be passionate about and people really want to engage with, it is the way to do it. It's the way to get them involved in that dialogue.
I mean, we get something every day. Today I got a girl Facebooked me and said, I need my ring sized. How long is it going to take me? You know, instead of picking up the phone, she could have called, but she chose to communicate through Facebook. And I'm on my phone, so I'm not sitting at my desk. So now I have to go through the link, and it would have been a lot quicker and faster just to communicate on the phone. But, you know, that's the way that she chose to communicate. And so me as a retailer, I have to meet their needs. In the same way that they walk in the door, I have to take care of their needs. And so if they want to communicate on Facebook or follow us on Twitter, then we're going to do it.
We're doing a lot to reach out to a younger audience. We're on Facebook. We're Twitter. We have a terrific website now. We're doing a lot of that kind of work. We're doing Girls Night Out. We have a number of projects that are geared toward using social media to attract a younger audience.
The number of page views that happen at WKYC.com because people come from our Facebook page to WKYC, I think for all of the year 2008, we had 20,000. For just last month, we had over 900,000 page views that got moved to WKYC.com. So primarily we use Facebook as a promotional vehicle. And we have a lot of newsroom video that gives people the opportunity who really want to connect, really want that behind-the-scenes look to connect with our producers, our editors, our floor directors, our assignment editors. Typically, you'll see them in flip cam videos teasing what it is that they're going to be doing in their traditional broadcast programs.
So, Jim, let's be honest. Social media, nobody's really monetizing it. They're having a real hard time figuring out how to make it pay. Have you figured it out? Are you monetizing it?
Here's the problem with monetizing social media. It's a lot of hard work,
yes.
Right? and people are inherently lazy. Small business owners and traditional broadcast companies and everyone who's been in business for the past 300 years or whatever, those people are used to getting out their checkbook, writing a check, and sending it off and having some ads run. And then some people come in and they go, oh, look, we got customers because we wrote the check. And that's the problem. People are lazy and they don't want to dig their hands in. What would you rather do? Spend a lot of money or spend a lot of time? There's always more time. In today's economy, you don't have a lot of money. So if you can go into social media and spend the time, you can make it monetized.
And it is cheaper, right? You think that's why social media has picked up a lot?
It's obviously a strength. If it was extremely expensive, it would probably be less popular.
Right.
I went into reporting about social media, you know, with the standard reporter's skeptic's hat on, which is probably a good thing. I don't own any sort of stock in any social media companies, unless it's in a mutual fund. But I've been pretty impressed in the reporting I've done with how businesses are using it.
Okay.
For instance, there was a specialty pharmacy on the east side of Cleveland that they do handmade medicine because mm-hmm. certain types of people need certain types of medicine. And so they follow autism groups on Twitter
okay.
to, you know, sort of, spy on their audience for the mm-hmm, most part. Mm-hmm. But then they also use it to connect with that audience, you know.
One-to-one.
Find good niches that
find
way.
Find a niche. Yeah. Is it really niche, Marcy? Is it have we lost mass media forever? Is it now all niche?
I don't think so. And there are people who are making money. I mean, Google is making a ton of money.
This is true.
The people who invented Twitter just turned down a deal to sell it for over $1 billion. So they'll probably sell it for a lot more than that.
Okay.
I mean, for the
so
rest of
us. So there's
at
least five or six people out there making.
There's a couple of people. But for everybody else right now, until we figure out how to monetize it,
yes.
It is an investment.
Okay.
And you do need to make investments in order to grow your business. And in the meantime, you know, you get contacts and exposure from it, so it's still
important.
And
I think that's one of the biggest mistakes, I think, that we saw some of the clips of people were talking about. And I don't know if it's necessarily a mistake. I just don't think that people know what to do with social media yet, so they're turning to the, it's a great promotional thing.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
And, you know, that's going to morph. We're going to see that change in the next couple of years. They're going to see that people are actually going to be able to start generating revenue from those things.
From the social media piece. Right now, they're not getting the revenue from that. They're using it to promote their main revenue stream.
They are, and that happens at our company, too, because our top referring sites come from Facebook and Twitter and take you
right.
to Akron News Now. So, yes, it is
so,
used for that.
The question is, do these traditional media organizations stay in business through this transition, or do new ones like Google or Facebook or Twitter come up and literally take that advertising money away, because that's what they've done?
We got time, right? You work for a print publication.
Right.
And I don't think that you're going to go under in the next 5 years.
Say without making my bosses mad that I don't think we will.
Right. So I think that what happens, Thomas, is that there's a lot of people kind of getting freaked out about this stuff. And I don't think this stuff is going to die anytime soon. I don't want to be one of those people coming out and go, stop all your advertising, don't do any of that stuff, and move it here. That's not what I'm telling people to do.
Is it the fact that the demographics are shifting too? The fact that the younger generation is not reading newspapers really at all? They never have. They're not watching network news programs like
No.
they have. They're getting a lot of stuff on the web, on their mobile phone. Is that really where we're headed? The fact that the audience will take us there, whether we want to go or not?
They're deciding. You know, they're deciding what they want. And, you know, I'm 38 years old, but I'm an old guy in the internet business, right? Because
right.
I got started 15 years ago. So, you know, I think I'm deciding where I want to get my content from. I live a fast-paced internet life, and I got to get it where I want it as fast as I can.
But it is a fallacy, too, that it's only younger people using social media.
That's
because
true.
You know, between Twitter and Facebook, there's 400 million
Absolutely.
Users or
yeah.
something like that.
Yeah.
And on Facebook, the latest statistic I saw was that the fastest growing segment was 55 yeah. plus, and the bulk of Twitter's users are over 35. So, you know, you got to be careful not to skew everything to the younger audience yeah. because that's not the growing segment there.
That's right.
And I'd say that as far as some industries go, I don't know if we're just talking about traditional media's use of social media. As far as other industries go, I think people are monetizing it because they're using it to create relationships, to build prospects, I've talked to people that are using it and have said, yeah, I sold a house because I met somebody and then I took it offline and negotiated. But as far as traditional media, yeah, I mean, we're getting a lot more hits through our Twitter posts. I guess somebody who clicks through on Twitter to a Crain site stays there three times as long as a Google click through.
Interesting.
So that made my bosses really into Twitter.
Mm-hmm. And I'm with you on
but
that.
But it's not, yeah, I mean, if we'd have to, you could possibly create some new way of distributing information via Twitter instead of just leading everybody to your website. Haven't figured that one out yet.
But you know, I think that monetization doesn't have to mean ad sales. You know, monetization can mean leads, monetization can mean publicity, can mean subscribers, it can mean a million different things. And I think traditional media and everyone's still really focused on just getting that check or that transaction, which is really still important.
It's the platform with the new traditional media platform.
It absolutely,
yeah. It's not going to work. And you're absolutely right about that, because we get a lot of leads off of our Facebook page for stories that then we produce and then we broadcast and we make money there. And we get ratings, and it does monetize it.
I have a question. What's going to be more valuable in 10 years, having 500,000 Facebook people and your Facebook fan page or 500,000 subscribers to your publication? You know, think about that for a second.
That's interesting. That's great. Thank you all very much. Thank you. Now let's turn to Stacia Ertis at the Business Journal in Youngstown for a look at some of the top headlines from around NEOtropolis. What's new, Stacia?
Thanks, Thomas. The Akron Beacon Journal reports that three local organizations are teaming up to build a database of suppliers and vendors for global companies to use when they come into the area looking for local manufacturers. The Kent Regional Business Alliance, the University of Akron Research Foundation, and the Greater Akron Chamber hope to develop important economic partnerships in the region. AirTran begins its new nonstop flights into Milwaukee from the Akron-Canton Regional Airport. The new flights help connect Northeast Ohio with AirTran's growing western hub. Crain's Cleveland Business reports the Flats East Bank project appears to be moving forward. $34.8 million of mainly tax-exempt bonds from the Cleveland Cuyahoga County Port Authority was recommended by a committee for use by developers of the $278 million project along the Cuyahoga River. Members of the Youngstown-Warren Regional Chamber leave this week for an international business mission to Israel. Included in the delegation, the mayors of both Youngstown and Warren, as well as representatives from local manufacturing companies in Youngstown State University. And finally, the National Freedom of Information Coalition will receive a $2 million grant from the Knight Foundation to help fund court costs, filing fees, and depositions for freedom of information lawsuits. Because of the current economy and the evolution of news media, 60% of states report that FOI lawsuits have fallen off dramatically, with an even higher percentage expecting similar litigation to decrease in the next 3 years. And those are this week's headlines. Let's send it now back over to Thomas.
Thanks, Stacia. So we're finding now that the changes in media are actually affecting the way news is reported and the way news is collected, the way it's sold, and now these freedom of information filings. Is the Internet actually changing everything, Marcy? Everything about the Internet is changing the news business?
Well, probably, yes, yes. And it is very expensive to do that kind of journalism, and newsrooms across the country are losing people, so I can see how that would happen. And again, I think it's going to be a shakeout, but that kind of investigative journalism will still be done. I think it'll just be done a little differently. Again, probably more in-depth pieces from investigative journalism houses, more collaboration. Okay. I know there's a collaboration here between different law schools in Northeast Ohio that work pro bono on public affairs pieces. That's probably what you're going to see happen there.
Right. Are we seeing more nonprofit groups get involved in this kind of stuff, Jim? Is it going to, that sort of hard news investigative where you got to, you know, be there for 3 months, is that going to go over to a nonprofit situation?
Well, the problem with it is that there's no money in it.
That's right.
Right. There's no money in sending somebody undercover for 3 months to try and take down
to write one story.
I mean, the newspapers If you looked at them over the last couple of years, before the recession hit, before social media started to come around and everything, there wasn't much investigative journalism happening until subscriptions went down. And then you saw people going out there, we better start really covering these things, in my perspective at least. This is what I saw. But I think that, you know, citizen journalism is really what's going to change all of this stuff. I mean, the people, you know, with cameras everywhere you go, there's going to be any privacy. And these people are going to uncover stories that nobody else could have got because they're there at the moment.
And there are nonprofits that do fund investigative journalism.
Right.
And, you know, another change is that editorial boards used to sit down and say, we're going to cover this piece, and this is how we're going to cover it, and you're going to do it, and this is how long. And now, again, to your point, citizen journalism, they're telling you what they want to see.
Right.
And again, you can get that from Facebook, Twitter, internet, email, or whatever. And those are the pieces that you're going to cover and put your resources toward.
I definitely want to remind everybody that those numbers, long-term, yes, because of the changing dynamics of the industry, yeah, I'd imagine that those would be going down anyway. The recession has driven them down very sharply.
Exactly.
That's a good point.
When the recession hit, our advertising took a huge hit right away. We're hoping it all comes back. We can't count on it all coming back. But I'd say that, one, there's a huge demand for investigative journalism, even if it's not profitable, you know, even if that one story is not going to produce, you know, X amount of dollars to pay for the story.
Yeah.
The demand will be filled somehow. There may be a lull. It'll be filled somehow. But I think that in a way, if you look at it in a one way, it may not be directly profitable, but it's indirectly profitable because you've got, it's like a promotional tool. People want to subscribe to your paper if you're going to write stuff like that.
Great. Thank you very much. Let's check in with finance expert Kevin Meyerhoff for the stock report. Kevin?
Thanks, Thomas. This week we have five stocks that affect us up here in northeastern Ohio. First, out of Columbus, Ohio, is Big Lots, symbols BIG. Their midweek close was $29.34. Their 52-week low was $12.62, and their high's been $29.75. Year-to-date, they're plus 1.24%, and for 3 years, they're a positive 26.36. Nice to see those three-year returns. Then, second, PNC Financial Service Group. They're from Pittsburgh, but they own National City Bank. They're the ones that acquired them, so they really affect us up here in northeastern Ohio. Symbols PNC, midweek close was $54.05, 52-week low was $16.20, high was $57.86. Year-to-date, they're up plus 2.39, but over 3 years, financial service company still down a negative 27%. Next one is Rockwell Automation Corp. They're out of Milwaukee, but with lots of employees and lots of operating facilities right up here in northeastern Ohio. Midweek close is $48.25, 52-week low is $17.50, high is $49.25. Year-to-date, they are positive 2.7%, and over 3 years, a negative 19.31%. A name that we all know, Wendy's. Now, they were recently purchased by Arby's. Wendy's started right here in Columbus, Ohio. Now their headquarters with the purchase of Arby's is in Atlanta, Georgia. Their symbol is WEN. Midweek close is $4.40. Over the last 52 weeks, they were as low as $3.55 and as high as $5.80. Year-to-date, they're a negative 6.18, and over 3 years, they're a negative 79.51. Not very good. And last, right here in northeastern Ohio, Park Ohio Holdings Company, Mayfield Village, Cleveland, symbol PKOH. Their midweek close was $6.01. Over 52 weeks, they were as low as $1.65, as high as $9.32. Year-to-date, they're a positive 6.37%, and over 3 years, down a negative 62.86. Back to you, Thomas.
Thanks so much for spending your evening with us here in NEOtropolis. We hope you learned something about this diverse and resourceful region that we all share. And remember, we want to hear from you on Facebook, Twitter, and at NEOtropolis.org.
Funding for NEOtropolis has been provided by the Burton D. Morgan Foundation, committed to the free enterprise system. Key Private Bank, offering a broad, integrated, and objective perspective on managing wealth, with more than a century of banking, trust, and investment expertise. Key Private Bank is on the web at key.com/KPB.
Magnet, the manufacturing advocacy and growth network, supports and champions manufacturing in Northern Ohio through product development and consulting services that help companies grow in today's global economy. Information online at magnetwork.org.
Kent State University, one of Ohio's premier universities, celebrating 100 years as an engine for economic, cultural, and workforce development. That's excellence in action. It's happening every day at Kent State University. Information available at kent.edu.
The Dominion Foundation. JumpStart, working with entrepreneurs to accelerate the growth of their high-potential businesses to create a more prosperous economic future.